night, Philippine authorities intercept a vessel loaded with suspected smuggled sugar in Subic Port in the northern province of Zambales.
Health authorities detect two new monkeypox cases in the Philippines.
The Philippine Senate under total lockdown as two more senators test positive for COVID-19.
And Russia rejects calls to withdraw troops from the Zaporizhzhia nuclear power plant in southern Ukraine.
Good evening, I'm Tony Velasquez.
And I'm Pia Gutierrez.
On our broadcast tonight, Philippine authorities seize what they suspect is a smuggled cargo of sugar as the country grapples with a short supply and high prices of the sweetener. The government says it will make the commodity cheaper after getting major supermarkets to agree to reduce their sugar prices. Jervis Marahan has tonight's top story.
Leading supermarkets in the Philippines agreed to make available cheaper-priced sugar in their stores after a dialogue with Executive Secretary Vic Rodriguez. Malacanang says owners of Robinson Supermarket, SM Supermarket, and Pure Gold Supermarket will sell sugar at the suggested retail price of 70 pesos per kilo next week, from the current high of 90 to 110 pesos per kilo. But there will be a purchase limit to prevent hoarding.
Para po lahat ay makapag-avail, nililimita po to 1 kilo per customer. Actually, napakiusapan lang po sila ni Executive Secretary Vic Rodriguez na bilang tulong na lang sa ordinaryong consumer na pababaan kahit pansamantala ang kanilang mga presyo until ma-resolve natin o maitawid natin hanggang itong Setyembre or sa harvest season, na baka naman maipababa na natin by that time ang presyo ng asukal.
President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. lauded the response of the companies, which he says are sacrificing not just their own inventory, but also their projected business profits for the sake of ordinary Filipinos. Meanwhile, government is investigating if the reported sugar shortage in the country is artificial.
Kahit sa kasalukuyan, nagsasagawa ng simultaneous operations sa Deparo, Caloocan, Balot, Tondo, at San Nicolas sa Manila, Rosales, Pangasinan, San Fernando, Pampanga, Ibaan, Batangas, at sa Davao. May iba na nagresulta sa pagpupresenta ng questionableng mga dokumento, may iba naman na nakapagpresenta ng maayos. So tuloy-tuloy pa rin ang mga operasyon natin para at nagpapatunay ito, sabi ni Executive Secretary Vic Rodriguez, na seryoso ang kampanya natin sa para malinis ang sindikato ng hoarding at illegal importation ng asukal.
On Thursday night, the Bureau of Customs intercepted around 7,000 metric tons of allegedly smuggled sugar in the port of Subic in Zambales. The shipment was found in a cargo vessel from Thailand and is supposedly bound for Rosales, Pangasinan. Customs officials flagged the shipment after receiving a tip. It used a recycled import permit.
For verification po kasi, supposedly lahat naman in order, albayit na sila ng tax sa custom, not until merong dumating po na tip na na-fail daw yung na-recycle lang daw yung papeles. At yung papeles ngayon ay bine-verify kung totoo bang ito ay recycled na pinake o totoo, original o kaya legit.
If the permit is verified to be legitimate, the shipment will be cleared to enter the country. In San Jose del Monte, Bulacan, the warehouse inspected by BOC remains locked up. The owner denies he is hoarding sugar supply.
Hindi naman kumot naka-imbak eh, hoarding na, di ba? Kasi nagdi-deliver naman tayo araw-araw eh.
He said the employees are anxious because they cannot work while the warehouse is closed. Also on Thursday night, the Sugar Regulatory Administration inspected the warehouse of one of the biggest sugar traders in Manila. But they only found local sugar, and there were no signs of hoarding. The Philippine Chamber of Commerce and Industry says they are pleased with the government's response to the sugar crisis.
But we're very happy that the BBM looked into the matter and assured the public that there is enough sugar inventory in the pipeline to carry us forward. But that, at the same time, the president is open to the idea that if there's any indication there's going to be shortfall, then the SRA will authorize importation of sugar, but not of the quantity as what was ordered previously.
Malacanang meanwhile clarified that proposals to allow industrial sugar users to import their own supply is still being considered by President Marcos Jr. Jervis Manahan, ABS-CBN News.
Monkeypox infections climbed to 3 in the Philippines, with 2 more cases reported Friday. Despite this, authorities are not inclined to tighten border controls. Rafael Bosano reports.
The Department of Health confirms the country's 2nd and 3rd case of monkeypox in individuals aged 34 and 29 years. The Philippine Health Department says both have travel history to countries with confirmed cases of the illness. One tested positive via PCR last Thursday, while the other was confirmed positive on Friday. To protect their privacy, the DOH did not release their gender and location. Health officer in charge, Maria Rosario Vergere, says aside from the early signs of the illness like fever, the new cases also developed lesions on their body.
Hindi na matandaan din actually no nung ibang pasyente kung saan nagsimula. Pero dito po sa ating mga pasyente, consistent naman na meron sila sa mukha, meron din po sa ibang parte ng katawan, meron din pong lesions also in their areas na sensitive. So I don't think that this is different. Ito pong mga lesions na ito, kailangan malaman ng ating mga kababayan na hindi po agad-agad na magkakaroon kayo ng lesions sa inyong katawan. Maari pong mag-umpisa ang sakit sa pananakit ng katawan, naglalagnat kayo, tapos after mga 3 to 4 days, tsaka po lumalabas ang mga lesions na ito.
She adds, based on their analysis, the 2 cases were not infected in the Philippines.
Sila po pareho galing sa ibang bansa na mayroong mga identified cases of monkeypox. Their incubation period from the time that they were exposed or the time they were in another country hanggang dumating sila at nagmanifest ng symptoms ay kapareho po at pasok doon sa sinasabi nating incubation period ng monkeypox.
The 34-year-old patient is currently undergoing home isolation while the 29-year-old is isolated in a medical facility. 17 close contacts have already been identified. Contact tracing for both patients are ongoing. Meanwhile, the first case of monkeypox announced by the DOH last July has already recovered. The patient's close contacts did not exhibit symptoms and have completed their isolation. The World Health Organization declared monkeypox as a public health emergency last July, but Vergere reiterates the public need not panic, especially since monkeypox and COVID differ in terms of transmission.
Ang COVID-19, yun pong virus niya, can travel sa air. Kaya tayo laging nakamaskara tayo dahil dyan. Pero itong monkeypox po, you need direct contact para kayo ay mahawa. Kailangan nyo pong magkaroon ng talagang malapitan, no? na pwesto dun sa taong merong monkeypox. Madikit kayo sa kanyang katawan.
The DOH also doesn't see the need to tighten or even close the country's borders. Instead, it urges the public to remain vigilant and adhere to minimum health standards. Rafael Bosano, ABS-CBN News.
The Philippine Senate goes into a total lockdown after more lawmakers get COVID. Senate President Juan Miguel Zubiri says the building will be closed until Tuesday while it's being disinfected. J.V. Ejercito and Nancy Binay are the latest senators who have tested positive for COVID. Both are isolating, with Ejercito saying he's not experiencing any symptoms. 5 other Philippine senators recently caught the virus.
The Philippine Health Department logged over 3,700 new COVID cases Friday. More than 1,000 of these cases are in Metro Manila. 40 new COVID-related deaths were also reported. The positivity rate from August 14 to 18 is at 16.3%. The Health Department's officer in charge, Maria Rosario Vergere, says a plateauing COVID trend is seen in all of the country's islands except for Mindanao.
Ferdinand Marcos Jr. is making his first foreign trips as Philippine president next month. Press Secretary Trixie Cruz Angeles confirms the president will visit Indonesia on September 4 to 6. He will then travel to Singapore on September 6 to 7. Cruz Angeles says details of the president's U.S. visit are still being worked out. Marcos Jr. is expected to attend the UN General Assembly meeting in New York next month.
A U.S. congressional delegation finally meets detained former Philippine Senator Laila De Lima. The American lawmakers got court approval Friday to visit De Lima in her high-security detention cell at the National Police Headquarters in Quezon City. The group was turned away Thursday by police who told them to secure court clearance. De Lima's camp provided no details of the meeting except to say it lasted for over an hour. The U.S. delegation was led by Democratic Senator Edward Markey, who has long been vocal in calling for De Lima's release. Senator Markey believes De Lima has been wrongfully detained since 2017 by the administration of President Rodrigo Duterte. De Lima is among Duterte's staunchest critics. Duterte barred Markey from entering Manila in 2019 after the senator sponsored a resolution denying U.S. entry to Philippine officials involved in De Lima's detention on illegal drug charges.
The Rural Missionaries of the Philippines asks the government to unfreeze its bank account so it can continue serving the poor. Members of the church-based group were recently indicted for alleged terrorist financing, but the RMP denies this. It also condemns efforts to red-tag them, saying such actions put their members at risk.
Masyadong mahirap sa isipin na tayo tumutulong nire-red-tag. At ang pinutulungan namin ay ang mga magsasaka, yung mga indigenous people, tsaka yung mga nakatira sa malayo. Pero hindi ibig sabihin na pag may gumagawa ng pagsisira sa mission namin, pag-stop na tayo. No, tuloy pa rin ang pagtulong sa kapwa. Nandoon ang pangamba, no? Hindi yan nawawala. Pero naniniwala kami na ang Diyos ay nasa amin. No?
The RMP adds this is not the first time they have been harassed.
We still remember Father Paez. Mm-hmm. He is our RMP member. He was killed. He was shot when he was coming home after accompanying a prisoner, political prisoner, released already. Mm-hmm. Second, we have Sister Patricia Fox, a former national coordinator of the Rural Missionaries of the Philippines. And she has battled, you know, a deportation case, and this was successful, and we know that she has been deported. And that's why we are asking, why does this government really are seemingly putting all its resources at its disposal to shut down an organization of missionaries?
The Philippine Education Department claims most schools are ready for the return of in-person classes on Monday. But one teacher's group believes many of their concerns have yet to be addressed by the agency. Joyce Balancho with the details.
90% of the schools in the country are ready to implement face-to-face learning on Monday. That's according to the Department of Education. It says more than 24,000 or almost 46% of schools, including state universities and colleges and local universities and colleges, can do 5 days in-person classes. 51.8% will still do blended learning, which is a mix of distance learning and few days of face-to-face, while only 1% will use distance learning modalities. The department also reports 27 million of the target 28.6 million learners have enrolled already. 92% of the teaching and non-teaching personnel have received their COVID-19 vaccine, while only 19% of students are vaccinated.
We would all like 100% vaccination rate. The truth of the matter is the vaccination program of the national government is not mandatory. That's why kahit na po ganyan ang ating numbers, again, we will not discriminate. We will just have to strictly observe yung ating minimum health and safety standards para po sa seguridad ng ating learners, pati na rin po ng teaching and non-teaching staff.
The DepEd also said all schools have prepared their infection containment strategy. Before Monday, a new department order will be released, which will include details on the health protocols that should be implemented if a student or teacher gets infected with COVID-19. In the first week of classes, DepEd will also give out a 5,000 peso cash allowance to each public school teacher. This is aside from the funds given to schools for the purchase of face masks, alcohol, and other essentials to prevent the spread of COVID-19.
Ito po ay para masigurado na kumpleto sila sa mga kagamitan, especially for the minimum health and safety standards to be observed, tulad ng mga alcohol. Well, we are also requiring our schools na meron tayong stock ng mga face mask.
The Alliance of Concerned Teachers, for its part, said teachers had long been using their own money. It adds, the cash allowance of 5,000 pesos is not enough for a whole year of teaching. The group also claims that the DepEd statement that everything is well with the school opening is an outright dismissal of the numerous problems teachers are raising from the ground. It also alleges that many classrooms in Cebu and Bohol, damaged by the recent typhoons, have yet to be repaired. Joyce Balancho, ABS-CBN News.
Up ahead, a drought alert is raised in China.
The details when the World Tonight returns.
Back on the World Tonight, Russia rejects appeals for its forces to leave the Zaporizhia nuclear power plant in southern Ukraine. A Russian official claims doing so would make the plant more vulnerable. UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres had called on Russia to withdraw military equipment from the nuclear plant. Turkish President Tayyip Erdogan had warned that clashes between Russian and Ukrainian forces in Zaporizhia could lead to another nuclear disaster, similar to that of the Chernobyl nuclear facility in 1986. Turkey's leader and the UN chief met in Ukraine Thursday with President Volodymyr Zelensky to look for a solution to the war in his country.
China's President Xi Jinping and Russia's leader Vladimir Putin both plan to attend the Group of 20 summit in Bali this November. This was confirmed by Indonesian President Joko Widodo, more popularly known as Jokowi. U.S. President Joe Biden is also expected to attend the summit. It's still not clear if he will meet his Russian counterpart. Washington earlier called for Russia's expulsion from the G20 for invading Ukraine. Indonesia's president, for his part, is trying to broker peace between Kyiv and Russia. In June, Jokowi was the first Asian leader to travel to Kyiv and Moscow to meet with Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky and Putin. During the meetings, he called for an end to the war in Ukraine and solutions to the global food crisis.
North Korea rejects South Korea's conditional gesture of friendship. Kim Yo-jong, the sister of North Korea's Supreme Leader Kim Jong-un, shut down an offer of assistance from South Korean President Yoon Suk-yeol. President Yoon earlier said he would help normalize diplomatic relations between the U.S. and North Korea if Pyongyang ends its bid to develop a nuclear weapon. But the Supreme Leader's sister says Yoon is childish for thinking he could trade economic cooperation for the North's honor and nuclear weapons. Seoul, in turn, says Kim's comments were very indecent. North Korea showed its determination to continue its nuclear weapons program by firing two cruise missiles Wednesday, its first launch in 2 months.
Another record high number of COVID cases in Japan. It reported over 255,000 new infections Thursday, eclipsing the previous record of 250,000 reported on August 10th. The surge in cases now straining the healthcare system in many prefectures. The hospital occupancy rate in Okinawa Island has exceeded 100%. The number of infections is expected to increase further, with thousands traveling across the country for the Bon summer holidays. No mobility restrictions are in place.
Half of the population in poorer countries have now received their primary COVID vaccine series. Most lower-income countries have also vaccinated more than 80% of their highest-risk groups, including healthcare workers and the elderly. The COVAX Global Vaccine Alliance hails progress in closing the vaccine equity gap, but it admits more should be done to bring the vaccination as well as booster rates up. Since the first COVID vaccines became available, COVAX has shipped more than 1.4 billion doses to lower-income countries across the world.
A Filipino-American who took part in the 2021 U.S. Capitol riot is sentenced to 45 days in jail. Kenny Brian Lazo was arrested in Virginia in May last year. He pleaded guilty in March to four charges, including disorderly conduct on Capitol grounds. Lazo entered the Capitol building in January 2021 carrying a native Filipino broom while decked out in a helmet, goggles, and other tactical gear. He was among the thousands of supporters of former U.S. President Donald Trump who stormed the building as Congress was certifying President Joe Biden's poll victory.
The man accused of stabbing novelist Salman Rushdie last week in New York pleads not guilty to second-degree attempted murder and assault charges. 24-year-old Hadi Matar is accused of attacking Rushdie on stage. The incident has been described as an attack on the freedom of expression. It came 33 years after Iran's supreme leader issued a religious edict calling on Muslims to assassinate Rushdie over his book, The Satanic Verses. The book drew outrage among some Muslims who considered its contents to be blasphemous.
A drought alert raised in China as regions near the Yangtze River endure scorching temperatures. Beijing's weather office issued the yellow alert Thursday, two notches short of its highest warning. Weeks of extreme heat have caused parts of the Yangtze River to dry up. Responders are also scrambling to put out forest fires and protect crops across the river basin. The Chongqing municipality accounted for 6 of the 10 hottest locations in the country on Friday, with temperatures in its Beibei district hitting as high as 45 degrees Celsius. The mercury in Shanghai, meanwhile, reached 37 degrees. Officials expect the rising temperatures to last for almost the entire month. They also admit climate change is the cause of the ongoing heat wave.
Philippine Central Bank governor believes the country's inflation is nearing its peak. Governor Felipe Medalla is confident inflation will start to slow down towards the end of the year as market conditions improve.
The peak will come in September, October. Then after that, as global prices start to fall, partly because people expect the U.S. recession. Then we will have lower inflation. Where we are, technical speak for that is we are moving towards a target of this inflation target.
Philippine inflation hit a near four-year high in July. For the first 7 months of the year, it averaged 4.7%. That's below the central bank's forecast of 5.4%, but above the government's target band of 2 to 4%. The central bank has raised rates by a total of 175 basis points this year to bring down consumer prices.
Philippine shares resumed their rally as investors cheered the latest policy decision of the Philippine Central Bank. Michelle Ong reports.
Asian markets in limbo on Friday amid growing recession clouds, investors rushing to safe havens like the U.S. dollar, which is now nearing a one-month high. The MSCI Asia X Japan down 0.1% for the day and 1% for the week. As for the Philippines, the PSE index resumes its bounce a day after the central bank raised policy rates by 50 basis points as expected, bringing year-to-date increase to 175 bips to 3.75%. BDO Capital's Ed Francisco says clear messaging from the central bank is positive for the markets.
50 basis points increase was given. It was welcomed because it was announced and it was anticipated. I think the signals from the BSP are fine. We'll see if there'll probably be smaller rate hike increases. So I think the market is hopeful with that because now at least the Konglos and all the other corporates are planning. We're seeing positive signals. There's good government composition. The leaders are there. Seems to be an earnest effort. And then foreign buying has come back in already. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, because of the market opening up, we're seeing things positively. So I'm hopeful, but there'll probably still be some correction.
For the day, the PSE index gained over 0.5%, staying above 6,800, also notching its fifth weekly gain, supported by modest net foreign buying to the tune of 10.7 million pesos. In corporate stories, betting on revenge travel, Rojas & Company launched expansion projects under its Anya Resort brand in Tagaytay. It recently broke ground on Block 12, the latest addition to its 80-room luxury hotel. Meanwhile, another RCI subsidiary, Rojacoland, has finalized plans for the Anya Resort Villas project for launching end of the year. It will have 28 villas catering to market interest for high-end second homes outside the metro. And finally, the name change of SunTrust Resort Holdings Hong Kong-based parent Sun City Group to Let Group Holdings almost complete. SunTrust, which is co-developing Westside City Casino project with Andritan in Entertainment City, disclosed the name change was already approved by shareholders and even the registrar of companies in the Cayman Islands. The name is changed to Let, with L standing for leisure, E for entertainment, and T for taste, as part of the group's strategic business plan and direction focused on tourism-related business. Michelle Long, ABS-CBN News.
China's strict zero-COVID policy is being taken to extreme measures, with fish, crabs, and shrimps now being tested as well for the coronavirus. Xiamen City officials ordered COVID tests last month for fishermen and all the live seafood they harvest. The move was prompted by a COVID outbreak in a coastal city. Chinese authorities previously blamed the spike in COVID cases on frozen fish and other imports. The COVID-19 was first traced to a seafood market in China's Wuhan city. But the World Health Organization insists there's no evidence to show people can catch COVID from food.
Japan's government is asking the country's youth for an unusual favor. It has launched a campaign to entice them to drink more alcohol and reverse the decline of Japan's alcoholic beverage market. Japan's young adults are drinking less alcohol than their parents. Authorities hope the new campaign, dubbed Sake Viva, can help reverse the trend. But critics have accused the government of promoting an unhealthy habit. Our final word tonight is a quote from Elbert Hubbard. The best preparation for good work tomorrow is to do good work today.
And that is The World Tonight, the 19th of August, 2022. I'm Pia Gutierrez.
I'm Tony Velasquez from the Philippines. Thank you. Mabuhay!